Okay, welcome back, everyone. So we have the final ICTS Turing lecture by Professor William Bialek.
Not all of you were chased away by the marathon yesterday. That's good. So what I want to talk about today is a set of ideas that revolve around the optimization of information transmission. So it's often said qualitatively that life is as much about information as it is about energy. Obviously, in order to function, we need to be able to extract energy from the environment. We have to be able to metabolize it efficiently and so on. But it's also true that in some more abstract sense than that, we are called upon to do the right thing in many different situations. That means knowing something about the environment that we're in, tuning our actions in response, and so on. The question of whether the colloquial use of the word information in relation to biology should lead you to then think about the use of information in its proper mathematical form is something that has a longer and more complicated history. So many people are comfortable writing sentences in which they say that information is important. Fewer people are comfortable writing equations. And similarly, as I think we talked a little bit about in the first lecture, there's varying levels of comfort with notions of optimization in biological systems. I think one interesting thing is that if you're an experimentalist and you discover some mechanism, or you discover some feature of a known mechanism, and you explain this, at the end of the paper, you're allowed to say that this feature of this mechanism makes sense because it serves to optimize X. And no one will complain. On the other hand, were you to write a paper that began, consider the possibility that X is optimized, everyone would say, well, why would you think that X is optimized? So I hope that the first lecture served to at least introduce you to the idea that there are situations in which optimization doesn't have to be taken on faith, and you can actually check. And we're going to see some more examples of that flavor today. And these examples are going to be ones in which the quantity which is being optimized, either in our theoretical approach to the system or in apparently an experiment, is an information theoretic quantity. So before I launch into all this, I think it is important to ask why should organisms care about information theoretic quantities? They're very abstract. I mean, we have this theorem from Shannon that if you want to measure information, if you want to attach a number to the thing that we colloquially call information, this is the only right mathematical way to do it. But that doesn't mean that that's the thing that organisms care about. It could be that they're always interested in some vastly more specific question. And so this abstraction about gaining information is actually not useful. And that is a possibility. But I want to be sure that you know something about information theory, which is elementary in a certain context, but almost never mentioned in the biological context. And that's essentially, for those of you who know it by name, it's essentially rate distortion theory. So let me give you a baby example of a bacterium. And the bacterium lives in an environment which has a nutrient, let's say some sugar. And internally, in order to metabolize this sugar, It makes an enzyme. And we can imagine that the sugar has some concentration S, and the enzyme in the outside world, and the enzyme has some expression level or concentration E. And now the growth rate, call it lambda, is a function of S and E. Why is it a function of both of them? Well, and let's think about what this function is. Obviously, if this is the only thing available to eat, then how fast you grow is limited by what the concentration is. On the other hand, if you don't make the enzyme, you can't eat this thing. And if you make too much of the enzyme, you incur a cost for making the enzyme, which is not made up for by being able to metabolize more sugar because you've made too much. Okay. So this is a function that has some structure to it. And your job in life is to try and grow as fast as you can. Your bacterium, right? That's what evolution, that is what evolution selects for. That's fitness. And of course, if you only had to do this under one set of conditions and you're there forever, then eventually evolution will select for your being very, very good at that. But over the course of your lifetime, you encounter many different conditions. So in particular, this sugar concentration is going to be drawn out of some probability distribution. So what is it that biology cares about? What biology cares about is the average growth rate. Which is determined by the outside world. And by mechanisms internal to the bacterium that allow it to sense the concentration of the sugar and adjust the concentration of the enzyme to do as well as possible. And this is going to be noisy. So it's even if I fix the sugar concentration on the outside, if I survey lots of bacteria, I'll find that there's some distribution of enzyme concentrations. So this is your control mechanism. Now, what you might say is, well, why am I averaging? Just look at this function. If I hold S fixed, it has an optimum as a function of E. Why don't you just go there? And then when S changes, move to the new optimum. Well, the answer is that there's another quantity you can compute. Which is the mutual information between the sugar concentration on the outside and the enzyme concentration on the inside. So this is literally, if I look inside one bacterium and I see that at this moment the enzyme concentration is E, how much do you know about what the sugar concentration is outside? Or vice versa. If I tell you the sugar concentration outside, how much do I know about what the concentration of the enzyme will be in one bacterium? Yes. Let me do the case where the one body problem, right? Okay. So, or if you want the mean field theory in which the competition is expressed by the fact that that's partly what sets this sugar concentration. Yes. I'm trying to give you the simplest example. Let me keep doing this. I'll see if I can get back to that in just a second. So if when the sugar concentration has a certain value, the enzyme is expressed precisely to the maximum of lambda, then this mutual information will be infinite. And what that means is that somewhere in the apparatus that the cell has for sensing the sugar concentration and controlling expression levels, it needs a communication channel of infinite bandwidth. And it doesn't have that. So maybe we don't really understand all the details of how this, I mean, I don't know the mechanism by which the control actually works, but What's interesting is that just from these two things, the content of rate distortion theory is the following. Imagine that you build different bacteria that realize different functions, P of E given S. Okay? So some of them have some of them decide to invest enormous resources in control, and so they have very small noise levels. Other ones do less, they have bigger noise levels, they get less information, so on. Okay? What's remarkable is that if you make a plot of your average growth rate, so the thing that I tell you is this function and this distribution of environments that you live in. And now you're free to adjust this entire function. What you find is that there is a bounding curve. And things above this bounding curve are forbidden. Okay. And in a only slight abuse of terminology, this is the rate distortion curve. I mean, it's usually done in a different way. But essentially, the point is that if you set up the problem of, you know, what is this saying? This is saying that if you want to achieve a certain average growth rate, there's a minimum amount of information that you need. So the correct statement then is that this function is either concave or convex, depending on which way you think about it, such that it has a minimum when viewed as a functional of P of E given S. And since P of E given S enters only linearly here, if you put a linear constraint with something whose curvature is of one sign, then either the whole thing has a minimum or a maximum. And the way it works out is that there's a minimum. So what this is telling you is that the thing that biology cares about, this is a biological quantity. This is a theorist's quantity. Right? They're not the same. It is not true that maximizing information is a surrogate for evolutionary fitness. What is true is that if you want to achieve a certain growth rate, there's a minimum amount of information that you need. Now, there's two possibilities. Okay. One, and I said something about this, I think, on Monday. One possibility is that actually getting a lot of information is very, very easy. And so that means that real organisms are naturally out in this part of the axis. And so their job has nothing to do with moving along I. Their job is to figure out how to get up to here. Right? That is to say, given the information that they can collect, they need to use it correctly so that they actually achieve their maximum growth rate. Remember, just because you have the information, even you could have the relevant information, still do the wrong thing with it, right? When I tell you the mutual information, I've constrained what this distribution looks like, but I haven't told you its precise form. So, in some sense, if you live out here because bits are easy to get, then what evolution pushes for is effective use of the information that you already have. If, on the other hand, you live in an environment where bits are very expensive, then you're necessarily down in here somewhere. And if you've spent a long time evolving, you'll select for things that have higher and higher growth rate. And at that point, the only way to give yourself some space to grow faster is to gather more information. And furthermore, we know, I mean, I drew this with diminishing returns, not just because I felt like it. It's a theorem that it's curved this way, not the other way. So if you're in a regime where you have relatively little information. You know that the slope is higher. And so, in some sense, to give yourself space to do better in the sense that biology cares about, you actually must have more information. So the question of where real organisms operate, it's not a religious question about whether you believe that getting more bits is the goal of life, okay? The question is, are you over here or are you over here? And that's an experimental question, right? It's not something that we can answer theoretically. Okay? Now, I hope to convince you, of course, that we're over here, but we don't know in general, and in different systems, the answer might well be very different. Okay? But this is a reminder that information, although it's an abstract quantity, puts bounds on any quantity that you care about. So in almost any biological context where you think about processing information, the amount of that information puts a bound on any metric for performance that you might want to introduce. Okay? And that's fundamentally, I think, why organisms care about gathering information. It's because if you don't have the minimum amount of information, you can't actually carry out the task to a criterion level of performance. You asked about competition. Just as an aside, my colleague Chris Sims, an economist, like many economists, is thinking about the failure of the different idealizations of classical economics. So, as you may know, the classical economic actor is a creature who is has access to all necessary, says perfect information, and acts in a perfectly rational manner. So there's been a great deal of attention to the fact that human beings are not perfectly rational. There's been rather less attention in the economic context to the question of whether we have perfect information. And in fact, it's much more obvious that we don't have perfect information than it is that we're not rational. Okay? For many of the things that we have to do, our rationality is not so bad. The information we have, on the other hand, is quite limited. And so one of the things that Chris has been trying to think about is, in an economic context, what is the consequence of limiting the access of all the economic actors to information? And so he started in the sort of one-body version that we're talking about here, which is, suppose I have to set the price of something. And I have a certain amount of information about what the price is supposed to be, but not an infinite amount of information. And I, of course, know how to compute the cost of setting the price incorrectly. That's not that hard. So then what do I do? If I limit the amount of information that I have, what happens? And in something that's probably not unrelated to the phenomenon that Vijay was talking about just an hour ago, you'll remember that under certain conditions, he found that although you were trying to respond to a continuous distribution of molecules in the environment, you end up building a discrete set of receptors. So the same thing happens in rate distortion theory problems. As soon as you leave the very simple world of Gaussian distributions and quadratic costs and so on, you often find that the probability distributions which optimize information transmission become discrete. Right? They become singular. You get a kind of sort of quantization of the signal. It's not quantization with integer spacings, right? But you get a discretization of the signals. And what he and his colleagues have been thinking about is whether this is the origin of what's called price stickiness. So you know, you often find that things have, you go to the market, right, and you'll notice that the prices are not uniformly distributed numbers, right? There are particular prices that show up, and there are various theories about why this is. But what's even more striking is that if you watch these prices change over time, they come back to the same discrete levels, okay, which is in fact what you get from that kind of theory. However, whenever he talks about this, he always ends by noting that there's a very simple question you could ask, which is the competition question. Suppose I actually have a market, and all the actors in the market have limited information. Okay? You'll recall that, you know, the classical picture of economics, everybody has perfect information, they all set prices correctly. This is the efficient market hypothesis, right? And so then all the information about how much things are worth and everything is all already contained in the prices, right? But what if every actor who's setting the price has access to only a limited amount of information? It's a very fundamental question. Does the market clear? You know, will actually all the transactions get satisfied in that situation, or will the market get stuck? And that question's open. So.
Yeah, I mean, my motivation was more to, you know, the frequency-dependent selection in the sense.
Yes.
What you're trying to optimize, it's not a static landscape. You know, it also changes with the.
Yes. It gets much worse, but yeah. Okay. Yes.
How important is the price that you pay when you attempt to code doing things?
Change the continuum limit?
Sorry, say it again.
Is the price that you pay in going to the continuum about the information that you from discrete to continuum when you go? How important is that price?
Sorry. So the discussion we're having here, the variables are continuous. Maybe they shouldn't be, because the enzymes are molecules and they get made one by one. But I was giving this discussion in the continuous case. And the thing that I was referring to is that in problems of this flavor, you sometimes find that the solution produces a discretization. That you only use certain levels of your signaling bandwidth, right? So you, in principle, could have produced a continuously varying signal, but the optimal thing to do is actually to produce discrete levels. So if we think that, so the lesson here is that performance, which is defined biologically by some criterion that, you know, makes sense in terms of the natural history of the organism, performance requires a minimum number of bits. And so there must be a regime in which it's the acquisition of the bits that's actually the challenging part of the problem. Okay? We don't know whether real organisms are in that limit or not. But that's a place where we have a lot of theoretical tools, so we're going to look there and try and open that up and see what we can find. So let me, rather than starting with a biological example, let me do a little bit more mathematics, and then we'll switch to biology. Yes?
So what causes this biological?
It's the fact that there's a log there. It doesn't have anything to do with the, you can make up any function. The biology, okay. Let's ask, okay, what's where? So this is given to us by Shannon. It's a mathematical abstraction that's the answer to the question of how I quantify my intuitive notion of information. This is given to the organism from the outside world. This is biology. How much does it cost to make the enzyme? If you have this much enzyme, how fast will you grow? How do you eat the sugar? Da-da-da-da, right? And then this is all of the mechanisms that we're going to try and fiddle with. And what's interesting is that, you know, every mechanism you could make up, so draw a picture with one of the signaling pathways from sugar concentration, you know, put some receptor for the sugar on the surface of the cell, take one of the networks that Upi showed you this morning, put it in there, have at the output the control of the expression of the gene that codes for this enzyme. Okay? That's all in here. Every choice of that model is a point in this plane, generates a point in this plane. The important point is that without knowing anything about what goes inside that, I can tell you that all those points lie below this curve. Oh, if you want to know exactly what this curve is, it depends on this and on this. Yes, it matters. The existence of a bounding curve doesn't depend on knowing the form of P. Finding the bounding curve, of course, does. So let me do, so. So let's try out the idea that we're going to try and optimize the transmission of information. And so in order to do that, we're going to take the simplest case we can imagine, which is that we have an input x and we have an output y. And you all know what happens when you have an input and an output. You have an input-output relationship. It always looks like that, except in the cases where it looks like this. We'll worry about that for the moment. You also know that in any real system, that thing that you're drawing as the input-output relation is not a complete characterization of what's going on. That's presumably the mean input-output relation. That is to say, if I deliver input x, what is the average value of y? There's an error bar that sits on top of this. And that error bar is not the error bar of my measurements. It's the intrinsic noise level of the system. That really, there is a probability distribution of y given x. And this curve that I've plotted here is the mean. And these error bars are the standard deviation. The mutual information depends, the mutual information between x and y, that is to say, how much observing y tells you about the value of x at the input, or vice versa, is a function of p of y given x and the distribution of inputs. So again, these are the inputs, and this is your input-output relation plus a characterization of the noise in that input-output relationship. And I can ask, how do I maximize this function? Right? I'd like to transmit as much information as I can. I'd like it to be the case that if I build a receptor, I get as much information as possible about the thing that I was trying to detect in the outside world. Well, it turns out that there's several different ways of thinking about this. The most straightforward way is to imagine that your input-output relationship is fixed, and you go to different worlds, and you try to find the world in which you can gather the most information. So vary the distribution of inputs. So you can maximize this with respect to the distribution of inputs. And in general, that's a very hard problem. However, if we're willing to make an approximation, which is that the noise level is small in some sense that, of course, you have to dig inside the theory and find out exactly what you mean by small. But maybe the way to think about this is that I can compute, if I imagine that this probability distribution, this conditional distribution is Gaussian, the mean is given by the input-output relation, and the standard deviation is given by this error bar, then I can do a systematic expansion of the mutual information in the size of this noise. Okay? And let me keep the leading term, and then do the optimization. When you do that, what you discover is that, okay, the noise level depends on the input. But if the noise level is small, then if I know what the output was, I can go look up what the input was. And then I can look at that point and ask how big was the error bar. So I can think of the noise level also as being a function of the output. If you go through this optimization in the limit that sigma y is small, what you find is that the probability distribution at the output of the system should be inversely proportional to the standard deviation. What does this mean? It means that if when you try to say something, it always comes out garbled, don't use that, don't say that very often. Okay? So those of us who struggle in foreign languages are very well aware of this problem, right? You avoid construction, you know, you avoid constructions that you're likely to get wrong. Okay? And in this limit, the way in which you do that is very simple. It's just proportional. In particular, if the noise level were uniform and small, then this would say that you should use all the output levels equally often. So that means that the distribution of inputs, when you push it through the input-output relation, should somehow come out uniform over the dynamic range that you have available to you. So some of you will know this from image processing. It's called histogram equalization. Right? If I've only got 256 levels in which to describe an image, describe each pixel, I would like to map intensities into pixels, into pixel values in a way such that I use all 256 levels equally often, because otherwise I'm writing down numbers that don't carry as much information as they could. Okay? And of course, quantization is the case where, in some sense, the noise level is uniform. That is to say, you can tell the difference between 200 and 201, and you can tell the difference between 7 and 8, but nothing else, right? So there's a kind of uniform noise level in the system. Okay. So one way to think about this is that if the input-output relationship is given to you with the noise level, then this determines the distribution of things in the outside world that that you should like to find so that you can be as informative as possible about what's out there. But you can think about it in another way, which is that if you know that your noise is small and Gaussian, then and determined by the value of your output, then you know that you should adjust your input-output relationship so that this comes out to be true. In particular, if the noise is uniform, what you can think about is that your job is to take the distribution of inputs and reshape it so that the output distribution becomes uniform. So an example of this, as I say, if sigma is constant, then P of y is constant. And what you can then show is that with appropriate normalization, the input-output relationship is just the cumulative probability distribution, or alternatively, the derivative of the input-output relation should be the probability distribution of inputs. So what does that mean? It means that if your noise level is uniform and small, then what you want to do is put your point of maximal sensitivity, highest slope, in the neighborhood of the signals that are most likely to occur. That feels sort of sensible, right? You have a limited dynamic range to work with, and you have a noise level that tells you that you can't distinguish arbitrarily small things. So the best you can do is to operate in the place where the slope is high, so in the place where signals actually occur. And then how far should this, you know, how should this function tail off as you go to the extremes? Well, the answer is it should tail off so that the distribution of signals that actually occurs is sufficient to drive you through the full dynamic range. Okay, so in some sense, I mean, when you draw a sigmoidal curve, I mean, this is a statement about functions, but let's be realistic. This curve, you know, you can always normalize things so it runs from 0 to 1. So it has a midpoint, and it has a slope, which basically determines your dynamic range. And so the answer is that to optimize your information transmission, you should put the midpoint of your operating range at the most likely value of the signal. and you should make the width of your sensitivity match the dynamic range of the signals in your environment. So in 1981, Simon Laughlin did a wonderful experiment. He looked at the fly's photoreceptors and then at the cells that come immediately beneath it. Let's see how to draw this. Let's just do it like that. So he looked in, you remember the picture of the fly's compound eye with the lenses. He looked at these neurons. And he mapped their input-output relationship. So what does that mean? He exposes them to a constant background of light, and then he makes little steps up or down. And these are neurons that produce a graded voltage response. So what he plotted was the change in voltage that you get as a function of the change in intensity. And so, and well, it's a little more natural to measure this relative to the background. And so then zero is here, and you can only, the biggest negative signal you can get is minus one, right? You just turn the lights completely off. And what you get is that, you know, you have some vaguely sigmoidal input-output relationship. Okay. But what he then did was, he said, look, this cell is looking out through one lens. And I understand the optics of that lens, and I understand the wavelength sensitivity of the pigments that are in this receptor cell. So let me build a photodetector with an optical system attached to it that reproduces what the fly is doing. And then let me take that photodetector for a walk through the environment where I caught the fly and measure the probability distribution of light intensities that falls through that aperture. And then let me take the integral of that probability distribution. So this is the integral of the distribution of intensities. And these are the data. And they basically lie on top of each other. More importantly, you realize that all of the light that reaches, almost all of the light that reaches you, reaches your eye, is scattered, right? So the intensity that you see is the product of the source intensity and the reflectance of the last surface it's scattered off of. During the course of the day, it gets lighter and darker. It does not get lighter and darker because the scattering surfaces are changing their scattering coefficients, right? It gets lighter and darker because the source is being obscured or revealed. So what that means is that the intensity that you see is actually a product of two numbers, each of which has a distribution. Okay? You could say that the source is more or less a fixed intensity. It's not exactly right, but you can think about it that way for the moment. Most of the variation that you see in this room is a result of variations of the properties of the scattering surfaces, yourselves included. And over the course of the day, or alternatively, if I turn the lights up and down, what that means is that the thing that I see is the product of two numbers. One of them comes from a distribution, and then I multiply by something. And when the lights are bright, the thing I multiply by is a big number. When the lights are dim, I multiply by a small number. What does that mean? It means that if I talked about the logarithm of the intensity instead of the intensity itself, the probability distribution, when I go from bright lights to dim lights, would just shift linearly on the axis. But it would keep more or less the same shape. So that suggests that if I actually plotted this versus the logarithm of the intensity, then this would be the mean intensity. And if I now do the whole experiment again, but I raise the background intensity so that the whole distribution shifts, then I should see more or less the same curve, but just shifted over. And that is a very good first approximation to how light and dark adaptation work in your retina. So not only do you get a kind of semi-quantitative description of what the input-output relationship is under one set of conditions, you immediately get an explanation for how it should vary as you move through the world and experience different distributions. Now, in the real world, you don't only get variations in the mean light intensity. You also get variations in other features of the distribution. So if I spend my time staring or moving my eyes around this part of the blackboard, the intensity doesn't change very much. And then if I switch to looking at the rest of the room, now the intensity varies dramatically as I move my eyes through the world. So that means that the signals that actually arrive at the receptors are intermittent, right? There are periods of very low, small fluctuations, and then periods of large fluctuations. And this is true not only for light intensity, it's true for sound pressure at your eardrum, it's true for olfactory signals. In that case, the reason is a deep physical explanation. It's because the molecules are being carried to your nose by turbulent flows. Right, they're being evected by turbulent flows. The concentration signal is a passive scalar, and we know that that's one of the classic examples of producing an intermittent signal. It's true also for higher order features. So if you think, for example, about the motion of something, right, things, they stop, right, and then they start moving and they move around erratically or they move smoothly. If you're a fly and you're flying through the world, then if it's very still, you're able to fly very straight. And so as you look at the world, the angular velocities on your retina are very low. On the other hand, if the wind picks up, then you start being buffeted around, and you do control your flight, but there's a limit. And so the dynamic range of velocities that you see starts to increase. And if you decide to start yourself doing acrobatic flights, the distribution broadens yet further. So not only do we expect that there are situations in which the probability distribution of light of signals at the input to something, to a sensory system, can have the mean shift, there are also examples in which the probability distribution can shift its variance, right? And so you can move between high variance worlds and low variance worlds. And so when my student Dan Ruderman and I realized that this was a property of real images in the world and actually sort of analyzed that, you know, this is real, this intermittency is really where the long-tailed distributions of intensities are coming from, we realized that adaptation in the retina should involve not only then a response to the mean, but also a response to the variance. And so we went to our colleague Marcus Meister, who's then at Harvard, and asked him to try and do an experiment that would search for adaptation to the variance of the inputs instead of just adaptation to the mean. So how do you search for adaptation? The way you do it is you ask essentially, if I make a step, what does adaptation mean? I make a step change in something and I get a response, but then that response fades away as the system gradually readjusts its input-output relation to move the new signal back into the middle of the dynamic range. So what you expect, and that's one of the ways of, so that's what would happen here, right? If I suddenly jump from here to there, then I'm moving along this curve. But then if I spend enough time there, I start to think that I'm in the world that corresponds to this distribution, and I drop down to here, okay? But there has to be a separation of time scales, because if you think about this in terms of trying to process signals, you need to know that the distribution has changed, and it takes time for that to happen, okay? So you show the retina a movie in which you have flickering things, and then you suddenly change the dynamic range of the flickering. And so if you increase the dynamic range of the flickering, most neurons start generating more action potentials because there's more stuff happening. And then gradually, it relaxes back down on an adaptational timescale of several seconds. with, by the way, the editors of the August journal in which that paper appeared edited out references to things about probability distributions and variances in the introduction to the paper. So it reads somewhat oddly, but I'm pretty sure the content is what I just told you. Sometime later, with my colleague Rob de Ruyter, we returned to the fly visual system and to the problem of motion. And looking at the motion-sensitive neurons deep in the fly's brain, a postdoc at the time, Nava Brenner, did a really beautiful analysis of basically developing techniques that made it possible to map the input-output relationship of the neuron, where input is the velocity with which something's moving, output is the probability of generating an action potential, and developed very efficient tools for doing this mapping, which allowed you to essentially map the input-output relation with a dynamic range of 10 to the 3 in the output. And she showed that if you look at the probability of generating an action potential, generating a spike, as a function of velocity, so if you do this on, so here's 0. If you do this on a linear scale, you get something like this. If you now, that's if you do the experiment with velocities that are drawn from a stochastic process that has a distribution like this. If you now do the same experiment, but with signals drawn from a distribution that looks like that, what you find is that. Furthermore, you realize that in contrast to the case that, so Laughlin argued that he knew how to do this problem because he thought these noise levels were small and uniform, and therefore the answer was this histogram equalization answer. Now actually, even in the case that he was studying, it's not obvious that that's correct. In the case of a spiking neuron, it's obviously not correct. And in fact, we don't really know what you're supposed to do. However, if you think about it, if the noise levels are small, where am I going to get the scale of the input-output relation along the velocity axis? More generally, if I have a distribution of inputs, and then I have an input-output relation, and I'm optimizing the input-output relation, again, on the y-axis, you can always normalize. But on the x-axis, there's a physical signal. And so there's units here. Where are you going to get those units? The answer is from the distribution of inputs itself. There's no place else. And so what that means is that if the noise levels are small, so one possibility is that the scale here is set by the smallest velocity you can detect. But if that's not the answer, then the answer has to be that it comes from the width of the distribution itself. What that means is that if this is actually the solution to this information, so important idea here. I gave you an argument that if you're optimizing information transmission, you should rescale your inputs, your input-output relationship. We observe that you rescale your input-output relationship. That doesn't mean that information is being optimized, right? So the first thing is that you should check, does it actually work in the way the theory predicts? The theory predicts it should really rescale. So that means that if I plot this in units of the width, then these things should fall on top of each other. And I don't know, we can say this. Let's say they look like that and like that, right? So they should lie on top of each other. And again, I told you that what Nama had done was to work out techniques that allowed her to measure this input-output relationship on a logarithmic scale. And then it looks like this. And she could show that if you do this for several different distributions, they all lie precisely on top of each other. Furthermore, what this is telling you is that the neuron is capable of implementing a one-parameter family of input-output relationships that are related by a dilation of the x-axis. What I've told you is that the dilation of the x-axis is proportional to the width of the distribution, but there's still a proportionality constant. So if you say that, you know, I care about the slope of this line should be inversely proportional to this width, but what's the proportionality constant? So I can do the calculation. Imagine that the proportionality constant is whatever you want. How much information would you actually transmit through the system that implemented that input-output relationship? The answer is that the proportionality constant which maximizes the information transmission is the one chosen by the neuron. Okay? So these and many other examples in the context of coding sensory signals in neurons have led people to take seriously the idea that optimizing information transmission or optimizing the efficiency of representation really is a principle from which you can derive properties of real neurons and networks, okay? And there's more to say about this. What I'm going to do is to stop this part, because around the time that we got to this stage, I had the good fortune to start interacting with Eric Fischhaus, who's one of the heroes of developmental biology, for his work on fruit flies. And initially, Eric and myself and David Tank, who's an experimental physicist who's spent most of his career in neuroscience, actually in problems more like this than like the one that we worked on together. We started to ask whether we could use the early events in the fly embryo as a place to take these ideas about signals and noise and information transmission down to the level of molecular biology, to the level of the control of gene expression. So what's the idea? The idea, as I sketched on Monday, is I have the fly embryo, which is about half a millimeter long. The mother has placed messenger RNA for a few molecules at cardinal points. I'm not going to draw all of them. And so there's the messenger RNA for, let me call it protein number one. And I'll see if I can do the thing which is a favor to the physicist and an annoyance to the biologists, which is describe the proteins by number and not by name, because their names don't matter for this discussion. So I'm going to see if I can do without them. I might lapse into using the names. It's fascinating. Disciplines, you know, they're cultures, right? And so we engage, as with all cultures, we engage in ritualized behaviors. And to be accepted by a different culture requires your engaging in the ritualized behavior of the other culture. So it's fascinating to watch very sophisticated theoretical physicists who have become interested in biology, who in their traditional field of physics can barely remember a single fact, right? Because, as you know, you could get away with that in theoretical physics. That's why we all went into it. And you know, having discovered the wonders of biology, they give seminars in which there's this stream of facts and names and everything to establish their bona fides with the biologists in the audience. So I'm going to see if I can buck this trend. Protein number one is a transcription factor, so it activates the expression of other genes. The picture that you should have in mind, this is meeting about biological things, right? So you all know what transcription factors are, right? They bind to DNA. They do so near Well, in bacteria, they do so very close to the place where you start trying to transcribe the gene, and so you can have this very simple geometrical picture of the binding of one protein directly influencing the ability of RNA polymerase to get access to the site where it has to start reading. In animals as complicated as us, and even as complicated as a fruit fly, that simple geometrical picture is surely wrong, but it's still the general idea is right, that these proteins bind near the gene that they're going to regulate and influence transcription. So what you should think about is that if I measured the concentration of protein number one, it's a transcription factor that activates the expression of protein number two. So if I could monitor the concentration of this transcription factor and the expression level of the target gene, I would again see some input-output relationship that looks like this. The messenger RNA for protein number one is sitting here. It's tied down. But when it begins to be translated, the proteins are not tied down, so they move through the embryo. Whether they do so by diffusion or not is a long, complicated story. Doesn't matter, actually, for this discussion. They get taken up by the nuclei because they're transcription factors, so they function inside the nucleus. They get degraded. And when all is said and done, what that means is you have something like the problem of a box with a source at one end, diffusion and degradation. If you solve that problem, what you find is that the concentration of protein number one should look like this as a function of position, and it does. You can measure it. You can measure it by classical techniques of making antibodies against the protein and tagging the antibodies with fluorescent molecules. You can do it with modern techniques where you genetically engineer a fly that produces a fluorescent version of protein number one. You have to be careful to convince yourself that that you can actually knock out the original version of protein number one, put the fluorescent version back in, and everything works as it was supposed to. I'll remind you that you have that cephalic furrow that you can measure, and this protein, if you change its concentration, it moves the cephalic furrow. So if the cephalic furrow comes out in the right place, then you can be confident that everything is okay. And it's reproducible to 1%, so this is a very precise statement. So if this is the concentration profile of the spatial concentration profile of protein number one, and this is the input-output relationship, well, what you can see is that there's kind of a rough threshold called theta sitting here. So let's take this axis and put it over here. Here's theta. And so what does that tell you? Actually, let me put it more where it's likely to be, given my drawing. That tells you that in the front half of the embryo, you're going to be well above threshold, and the concentration of protein number two will be high. In the back half of the embryo, the opposite. And so I should see something like this. Number two. And there is a protein number two, and it does indeed do approximately that. And in fact, what you can then do is to go in and look at the individual nuclei. And in each nucleus, you can measure the concentration of protein number one and the concentration of protein number two. And instead of just thinking of this as some abstract thing, you can actually get means and error bars. Okay. And this, in contrast to the assumption that Laughlin made that noise levels were uniform, this noise level has a lot of structure to it. And there's a reason for that. Let me give you back of the envelope theory for what the noise level at the output of such a system should be like. So let me call this G, because it's the expression level of a gene. So the variance at the output, well, you're making molecules. And you make molecules discretely. You make them one at a time. The things you make one at a time actually are the messenger RNAs, not the proteins. So you get a sort of amplification effect. But at some fundamental level, in order to make a molecule, you have to execute elementary molecular steps. Elementary molecular steps are random. And so that means that if you measure that if there was a single random molecular step that produced the synthesis of every molecule, then it would be a Poisson process, and the variance would be equal to the mean. If there are k steps, then the variance will be k times smaller or k times larger, depending on which way you think about it. But the important point is that there'll be a factor out here which is proportional to the mean of the expression level. It's also true that this is a system. Now, there's many possible noise sources, but there's one more that you can't. So you can't get rid of this one. I mean, you might be able to discuss exactly what number goes out here, but there's got to be something like this. And there's one more thing you can't get rid of, which is that this is a system in which molecules go and bind to the DNA in order to regulate the output. The molecules have to make it to their target, but they arrive also by a random process. And so if you think that what the system is effectively doing is measuring the concentration of the input, then since what it's really doing is counting the molecules that arrive at a target, that randomness produces a shot noise. And so your measurement of the concentration itself has a noise level on it, which is, again, Poisson-like. But that's a Poisson along the x-axis. So you have to do the usual error propagation trick, right? And then you get a factor which looks like that, where gamma is another constant that I have to worry about. Okay? And so what that tells you is, from this term, the noise level should be low down here and large up here. And from this term, there should be a contribution which is low out here, and large in the middle. And indeed, if you plot sigma squared versus the average of G, that's what you see in this system. You see something that looks kind of like that. Okay? So this is coming from this term. This part is coming from here. If this is correct, well, first of all, this is what you measure in the data. This is a theory which looks like this. We may or may not be right, but that's, you can at least understand why it might look like that. I mean, basically, the question of whether you're right or not depends on convincing yourself that the numbers alpha and gamma come out right. That's a whole discussion, right? We won't have that one here, because I don't actually need it at the moment. In fact, I can take a very empirical point of view. Somebody measured this. Okay. So suppose that this is one of those cases where I'm trying to transmit as much information as possible. I have a situation like this. X is my protein number one, Y is protein number two. Why might I want to do that? Well, how does this cell know where it is? Right? This is embryonic development. This cell has to do something eventually. In order to do doing the right thing in the course of development means doing the thing that's appropriate to your position in the embryo. So somewhere you must acquire positional information, which is an idea in words, which is very, very old in the developmental biology literature. So what I'm asking you to do is to take that qualitative idea of positional information and take it seriously mathematically. Right? That if I want to be able to say, I'm the cell which is 36% of the way from the front to the back, and therefore I belong in the second segment of the body, then I somewhere need to get that number, 36%. Where does it come from? Well, the mother provides a background, right? She basically paints the embryo, dark over here, light over there. Darker means closer to the front, lighter means closer to the back. There are other signals too, but let's just focus on this one. But I can't act based on that signal alone. I have to use that signal to do something. What I do is I turn on some other gene. What I would like, since what's happening in that process is information is being transmitted ultimately about where I am, and that's the thing I really care about, I'd like to try and optimize that information transmission. if I'm going to do that, then I need to take this characterization of the mean input-output relationship and the noise level and pass it through this theory. It's not quite the case that the noise level is small, so you should really do it numerically, but for the sake of intuition, you can think about doing it, just doing it like this. And what does it predict? This predicts that if I looked at the probability distribution of the output, remember G now is the concentration of protein number 2, which I've already written down, so let me just put it here. If I look at that probability distribution, well, I told you that when noise levels are low, you should use those signals frequently, and when noise levels are high, you should use them infrequently. So you should use 0 very often, and you should use 1 reasonably often. There's a in this simple view, there's a cutoff at 1, but it gets smoothed out if you do the theory correctly. And things in between should be used not very often at all. You get something like this. So this is interesting because what I've done is to optimize information transmission, but I end up with something that looks like it's a bistable switch. And so you might be trying to think, but wait a second, if I'm taking this continuous thing and I just turn it into on and off, then at most I get 1 bit, and that doesn't sound like it's optimal. And it's not. In fact, if you go through the theory, you discover that, you know, there's actually a significant weight at these intermediate levels. And these intermediate levels are right in here, where the variation is actually telling you something about the input. The slope is high. The noise level is high too, but the slope is high. And so in fact, the information that you can pass through this if you were to realize the optimal distribution is more nearly 2 bits than 1 bit. Okay. So then the question is, what's the actual distribution? And the answer is, it's not perfect, but it's way better than we had any right to expect. Okay. The system is much more complicated than just having 1 input and 1 output. We're pretending that there's no dynamics. We're doing all sorts of terrible things, and we're focusing just on the problem of transmitting as much information as possible in this one regulatory element. And yet, we get this rather non-trivial prediction of what the distribution of expression levels should be across the entire embryo, and it comes out right. And furthermore, you can take the same data and actually measure how much information is transmitted. What you discover is that the amount of information that's transmitted is within 10% of the optimum. Now, we would like to get away from thinking about 1 input and 1 output because we know that's wrong. If I want to think about multiple inputs and multiple outputs, then I have to find a way to convince my experimentalist friends to measure multiple inputs and multiple outputs, and that's very hard to do. But remember that this is a system in which what is really important is information about position. Position is one variable. Furthermore, you don't have to do anything to the embryo in order to measure position. You just look where the cell is, okay? So you can put all of your energy into measuring multiple outputs. So let's now try to go to a network in which I know that there's a protein number 1 which feeds into protein number 2, but there's also a 3 and a 4 and a 5, and there's probably other things coming in here that I'm not thinking about. And we know that there's all sorts of interesting things happening here. Okay. And let me ask, okay, can I somehow lift this analysis up to something that's that complicated? Well, the important point is that what lives up here is really driven by position. That's what sets all those inputs. So I can ask, what is the mutual information between the expression levels of all of these genes and the position. Okay. So how do I do that? Well, I have to be able to measure the expression levels of all of these genes at once. Okay. And I have to do that in many, many embryos so that I can see if I'm sitting at precisely this point and I look across 20 or 50 embryos, what is not only the mean of the expression levels, but what's the entire covariance matrix, right? Because in fact, the fluctuations are correlated, and that matters. If I can construct that mean and covariance matrix, then what I've essentially done is to get an approximation to the probability distribution of the expression levels, given that you know x. Okay? What that means is that by Bayes' rule, you can construct the probability distribution the other way. And in fact, it's even easier than that because the distribution of positions is uniform, right? There's a, the cells are lined up uniformly through the embryo, so I don't even need to worry about that. And so if I can construct this probability distribution, I can try to construct the distribution the other way. And that says that when I look at a cell and I see that it has expression level G2 for protein 2, G3 for protein 4, 3, and so on, up to 4 of them, because that's the size of the network that people think is relevant, I can determine what x should be. And furthermore, since I know this distribution, I can also tell you how big my error bar is. And roughly speaking, what that's saying is that x goes into all the g's, but you can really think of that as saying that x has gone into an estimate that depends on the g's, right? You decode this information, and it has an error bar. And how much information you transmit then just depends on what this error bar is, because the thing that you're trying to measure is uniformly distributed.
Try to figure out if this distribution is, and the argument you're taking, is also a way of saying that this distribution is the is that which will give you the most robustness in terms of metabolic insults or anything else bad happening to the information transmission.
So this distribution is something we construct from experiment. Right. Okay. Now, let's say this distribution, which is the solution to an optimization problem, it's the solution to the problem of optimizing information transmission. Right. No other constraints. Now, it might turn out that that solving that optimization problem has other consequences as well. But we're blind to them in this analysis. Okay. So let me, I need to speed up a little bit. The end result of this analysis is you can basically plot your error bar, which I can think of as, right, this has a standard deviation, sigma x. I can do that, right? I can go in every embryo to this cell, and I can ask, what was its expression levels? Let me try and decode its position. I determine the errors, and then I look plot the variance of that at this point, right? I mean, presumably, if I'm doing this right, the estimates are consistent. So the only question is, how big is the error bar? If you try to do this based on a single gene, you get a mess, right? Because you can see that, for example, if you use this gene, if you saw a low value of the expression, all you'd know is that you're in the back half. And that's huge error bar, right? If you saw something in here, then you know a little bit more. But then again, if you see something big, you know, right? So if I use one gene, I get something where I have a nice low error bar in a small part of the embryo, but then I have a mess everywhere else. In fact, I have such a mess that describing it by an error bar is probably the wrong thing to do. The distributions are nowhere near being Gaussian. If I now take two genes, I can resolve some of these problems, but not all of them. And then I take three genes, and it's getting better. But finally, when I use all four genes, what I see is that the error bar that I get is almost perfectly flat. Furthermore, the level is 1% of the length of the embryo. So what this is telling you is that if you read out the expression levels of these genes, then that is sufficient to tell you where you are with 1% accuracy. So first of all, that's kind of amazing by itself. There are roughly 100 rows of cells. So this means that you have an accuracy which is sufficient essentially to tell where you are to one cell resolution. In fact, the small difference between an error bar of one cell and knowing for sure where you are plus or minus one cell is something we're still working on. But the fact that we've actually, it's about the tails of distributions and things, right? But the fact that that's what we're talking about now is kind of amazing considering where this all started. Furthermore, you may remember that I told you that the cephalic furrow is reproducible to 1% accuracy. But not only is the cephalic furrow reproducible to 1% accuracy, you remember those striped patterns of expression which provide the blueprint for making the segments of the body. The locations of those stripes are also reproducible to 1% accuracy, and that's true across the entire length of the embryo. So what we know is that every marker that we can measure that's downstream of these signals has an accuracy of about 1%. And we can get an accuracy of 1% just by looking at these signals. So that by itself doesn't tell you that that's how it works, but it tells you that at this level, there's enough information present in every single cell in one snapshot so that you don't need any more interactions with your neighbors and you don't need any more temporal integration. You have enough positional information locally in order to specify what's going to happen next. Furthermore, you realize that if you think of this as a problem of encoding x, then if I go all the way back to here and I think about what you do in order to optimize information transmission, what you should do if your error bars are small is have your distribution of inputs be inversely proportional to the noise level. Sorry, the distribution of outputs be inversely proportional to the noise level. But the thing, in this case, output is your estimate of the position. But positions are uniformly distributed. So if you want to if you want to represent position through the expression levels of a collection of genes, and you want to optimize your information transmission through that system by doing this kind of matching of the distribution of inputs to the noise characteristics of this network, then a consequence of that matching is that the noise level must be uniform. And that's what we see. And that uniformity is a highly non-trivial consequence of all of these interactions that are sitting in this network that produce very complicated spatial profiles for all four of the genes and the very funny variations of noise and covariances as you move along here. Something that we're very excited about is that when we did this a couple of years ago, I told you that implicitly, right, you construct this rule for decoding the patterns of gene expression. And when we wrote the paper about it, we didn't even show we didn't even try to visualize this rule. And the reason, of course, is that as long as you're only talking about, I mean, first of all, right, if there are four of these, then this is a five-dimensional object. What are we going to do, right? It's not really very interesting. However, if you think about it, this is a fruit fly, and in fruit flies you can do genetics. And the power of genetics is that you can interrupt the system in many, many places. You could try interrupting the network in here, but that would be kind of a disaster, right? Because we're asking how is positional information represented by the concentrations of these molecules. So if you delete these molecules, I don't know what's going to happen. However, what you can do is to start fiddling with the things that are sitting up here. And so now the network does its thing, and it produces patterns of gene expression. If we're right that our characterization of the code which is contained here, well, really here, right? If we're right about this, and this is how it works, that is to say, this is the code book that the embryo is using too, then if we look at a particular point in the embryo and we see an anomalous collection of gene expression values because we're in a mutant, we can plug it into this distribution and figure out what x that cell should think is its position.
In other words, if you increase the noise.
Well, you could think about, this is actually worse than increasing the noise, because you're when you knock out one of the inputs, you produce systematic changes. You're not just making the inputs noisier, you're actually changing their mean values, okay? So you're really disrupting the system in a big way. So what you can do, and this is work by a student, Mariela Petkova, it's really fantastic. She's done an amazing series of experiments, basically doing everything that, you know, took us years of experiments and analysis to do once. She's done it for, you know, various different combinations of deletions of the maternal inputs, and ground through the full analysis each time, and basically read out what the map would be. If you're a cell in this position, in this mutant, where do you think you are if you have the same code book that we got? And how do you tell whether you're right? Well, if you think that you're at a position that corresponds to one of those stripes, you should make a stripe. And they do. Almost every single half a dozen mutants, half a dozen stripes per mutant, all in the right places, including subtle quantitative variations where stripes have been moved by 5 or 10% of the length of the embryo. Okay. We're not quite done, and that's one where you should really look at the figures in order to see if you believe me, right? This is not a place where I should wave my hands. The paper will come soon, and it'll appear on the archive. So we're very excited about it. It suggests that somehow this line of thinking about information transmission, the thing which is at the core of it, you can actually, in these experiments on mutants, pull it out, unfold it, and it turns out that all the details that were buried inside it that weren't really a part of our analysis all turn out to be measurable and correct, which is really quite astonishing. So all of this has been about the optimization of information transmission, but the only thing we've really used is one idea, which is this idea of matching between the distribution of inputs and the input-output relationship and noise characteristics of the device. Can we do better than this? And in the last few minutes, I want to try and convince you that the answer to that is yes. So let's now leave the world of experiments and go back to a mathematical world where we have, for example, one transcription factor that broadcasts to several genes. And what I mean by this is along each of these arrows, let's say the concentration of this molecule is C, this one is G1, this is G2, this is G3, and so on. And what these arrows mean is that there is some sigmoidal input-output relationship. I also know that the system comes with noise, and we'll say that the noise really comes from a formula that looks like this. You'll notice that this formula has the property that it has a scale, which, if you think about this as being the Poisson noise associated with making the output molecules, this is essentially related to the number of independent output molecules that you're free to make. So it's a resource constraint, right? It says how many molecules are you willing to use. This combination of parameters sets a natural unit for concentration. Once you adopt that unit, there are no more parameters. So the only parameter in this theory is what's the largest concentration of inputs that you're willing to use? So again, how many resources are you willing to devote to this? And what's the largest number of molecules at the output? Okay. We can then say, let's parameterize these by sigmoidal functions and optimize with respect to the slopes and midpoints. And then ask, how do I maximize the information transmission from here to this combination of genes? The interesting thing is that the answer has two possible forms. One is that all of the input-output relations should be on top of each other. This is extremely surprising because it corresponds to complete redundancy. And I guarantee you that almost every card-carrying biologist would hold up redundancy as a counter-argument to optimization of information transmission. That redundancy is prima facie evidence that information is not being optimized. Because after all, if it's completely redundant, you could get rid of one of them. Wrong. If things are very noisy, you improve your measurement by doing the same measurement over and over and over again and averaging. And the best thing to do in a certain limit is to do exactly the same measurement over and over again. And so the optimal input-output relations all lie on top of each other. If you leave that extremely noisy regime and you loosen your resource constraints, then you transition to something that looks a little more sensible, which is a kind of tiling solution where the different genes come on with staggered thresholds. And then you realize, but wait, this still has redundancy in the information theoretic sense, right? Because if I know that G4 is on, I don't need to tell you that G1 is on. So how do I get rid of that? Well, suppose that, let's think about this. Let's let G2 repress G1. Then, let's see, maybe if I were consistent in my use of colors, it would be helpful. So let me add that. Well, then in that case, as G2 comes on, it turns G1 off, right? And then you can do more of these, right? And indeed, this improves your information transmission. There are other things you can do. This has interactions, but no feedback. If you start having feedback, then you know that the network can generate long timescales, right, because of the feedback effects. In fact, if you're not careful, the network can become multistable, as Upi was talking about this morning. So as you approach the transition to multistability, the timescale, the dynamical scales of the network get longer. And depending on where you are in parameter space, that can be a very good thing, because those long timescales tend to average out the noise. Okay? So having feedback can give you another level of noise suppression and hence increased information transmission. And there's actually one more trick that biology has up its sleeve, which is that no matter what you do, you always have problems down here where the concentrations are very, very small. And there is a way around that, which is that if you imagine that there's another molecule sitting out here, which is constitutively expressed, that is to say, you make lots of messenger RNAs. Now, in a sense, each of those messenger RNAs can independent, if this molecule can also bind to the messenger RNA, then each of those messenger RNAs can make an independent measurement of the concentration. Right? The difficulty down here is that fundamentally the system is working by having one or two or a small number of sites along the genome measure the concentration of this molecule. And if it's at very low concentration and you're only making one measurement at a little tiny site, you're screwed. There's nothing you do about it. Okay? So the best thing is to just avoid it, right? Don't turn on until you're in a regime where you can trust the measurements. However, if I have many messenger RNA molecules, if I had many sites, then I could average over all those sites and push down further and use the rest of the dynamic range. This molecule in the fly is a member of a very large family of transcription factors that turn out also to be RNA binding proteins. And when they bind to the messenger RNA, they regulate translation. And what we've been able to show is that the system is very likely in a regime where that extra step, even when you remember to correct for the fact that there's an extra cost associated with making all of those messenger RNA molecules, right? You should count that correctly. You still end up transmitting more information because of this averaging effect. So, what I hope to have convinced you of is that thinking about maximizing information transmission has given us, starting in neural systems and then extending into development, really a stage of development that's just about the regulation of gene expression, has given us a way of thinking about the behavior of these networks. One of the most powerful ideas has been this notion of matching, which in the context of sensory systems, I think is really quite beautiful. It wasn't our idea, so I can say that. What it's saying is, in a sense, it's giving you a mathematically precise version of something that a real biologist, a biologist who goes out, you know, in the field and looks at animals, knows in his or her bones, right? Which is that when you look at what a piece of the nervous system is doing, it makes sense only in context, right? You can't look at it isolated and ask, you know, what is this for? What's it doing? None of those questions make any sense until you see the context in which the system operates. This sort of matching condition is the statement that is, in a sense, the extreme version of that statement, that the whole input-output relation is determined by the context in which you operate. And in a sense, literally, the computation that your brain is doing, in this case, a very tiny piece of your brain, but you can imagine that this idea extends further, the computation that your brain is doing is determined by the structure of the world in which you live. And that's a really interesting idea. If you think about, you know, how do I think about the relationship between physics and biology? The answer is that my biology is built to match the physics of the world. Okay, and this is a way of trying to take those words and turn them into equations, still in very limited contexts. What's amazing in the context of the regulation of gene expression is you can take exactly the same mathematics. This plot that we generated from the fly embryo is mathematically testing the same principle as the one that Laughlin was testing 30 years before. Okay? We're using the same mathematical ideas in a completely different biological context, and it's giving us, I think, a very new way of looking at the data. And what it tells us is, first of all, that there's this amazing precision that's sitting originally hidden from us inside under the complexity that we can pull out, and there's a precision and there's a simplicity. And that, as I was describing in the experiments that are going on currently, and the analyses that are going with it, that the mathematical structure that's sitting underneath this, that's allowing us to draw these conclusions, actually gives us a way of interpreting, of sort of redoing, again, very classical biological ideas of trying to interpret the distortions in body plan that are generated by mutants in the developmentally relevant genes. But now we can do all that quantitatively. And again, because these precisions are so high, that quantitation turns out to be, again, proportionally precise. And finally, if you really take all this seriously, there is the possibility of having a theory of these networks in which the input parameters are how many of these molecules are you willing to make? And once I tell you those numbers, there isn't a single solution, thank goodness. There are multiple solutions for networks that are at least locally optimal in their transmission of information. And it turns out that already the features of these networks that we've been able to see, the staggered threshold with which genes are activated, the mutual repression, not just to relieve redundancy, but feedback to generate longer timescales, and the dual mode of regulation where you reuse transcription factors as translational regulators to extend your dynamic range to lower levels. Every single one of those features is a feature of this network that we see in the fly embryo. Okay. And the project for, I think, the next year, but one should be skeptical about these things, it might take longer, is to finish this calculation. See, can we really put, I mean, I told you about each of these pieces, but what we haven't done is to put all of the pieces together to have a theory of the whole network, okay? And to see whether when we finally do that, we get back a network that really looks like the one that we see in nature. So that's where we are. So again, I hope that in the course of these three lectures, I've managed to pique your interest to convince you that it's a nice time to be thinking about these things. The two more technical lectures, one was very data-driven, right? We were trying to build from that up. Here it was much more principle-driven, and you'll notice that they don't quite line up yet, right? And so I'm not gonna try and tell you what I think fits in between. I'd rather leave you with the notion they don't quite line up yet, and they're supposed to, right? But we don't quite know how. But in both cases, I think that it's been important that we think about a very wide range of systems, and that we think really hard about how to connect abstract principles in the sense that we're used to in theoretical physics with the nitty-gritty of the data that's emerging from biological systems, particularly now as those data become more quantitative. So thank you very much.
Just maybe a few questions.
So in the morphogenesis example, I mean, I noticed you were very careful to put arrows from protein 1 to all the other proteins. In some sense, there can't be any more information down there than there was any more mutual information about X than in the layer of things that right up on top. But so the real question is, for Turing patterns where there's no direct connection at all, but you get a wave and
yes.
you can still read out X.
Yes.
What's going on?
Okay, so. Let me make a little parenthesis about the first part. So remember that the way in which these experiments are done, one is taking snapshots of the concentration in single cells. So the statement that you can't have more information here than you have here is not quite true, because this can reflect an integral of that. And so things which look noisy in this snapshot can be averaged out, and cells can talk to each other. And so actually, that's a complicated discussion, okay? Everybody keeps trying to push us to do the simple version. It's not right. And so we have to figure out how to get our hands around that. The question that you ask about Turing patterns, let me amplify it for the people who maybe haven't thought about this. These are the Turing lectures. It's a really good thing to talk about, right? So you all know this marvelous paper about the chemical basis of morphogenesis. And so he gave us an example of a system of chemical reactions of molecules that are diffusing that have the property that if you start them in a state which is spatially uniform, that state is unstable, and you end up with something that is actually more likely like this. Probably a no-flux boundary condition, not a node, right? It's not a standing wave. And as a result, the concentration of this molecule, as McCune points out, now provides you with information about position. So in this problem, you could say, well, I understand where the information about position came from. Let's see, you know, there was something here, the molecules diffused, and so on. And so I started with a gradient, and I just churn away at it, right? But you could say, well, what you really started with was just the messenger RNA here. And so at time zero, the concentrations of all the proteins are all zero in here. And then as time goes on, the concentration of this protein comes up, and then it turns on these other things, and poof, out of nowhere, positional information appears. And this makes you nervous. Right? Information's not supposed to appear. There's no conservation law for information, but it's also not supposed to appear out of nowhere. And the answer is, both here and in the Turing pattern, is that where it comes from is the boundary. Right? That's very clear here. In fact, I mean, in some sense, drawing this is misleading. It so happens that before the genes in this network start being expressed, the spatial profile of this concentration has more or less come to steady state. It happens to be true. And so you think of it in these layers. But really, it's Turing, right? It's a bunch of chemical reactions plus diffusion and a boundary condition. And the information is in the boundary condition. And it propagates through. And so what one should think about, and we haven't actually managed to do this, is in some sense to think of this, you want to think of pattern-forming systems as being communication channels from the boundary. Thus, for example, if there's a little bit of noise in this system, you know that if this thing is reasonably small, that's not a problem. But if I made it this big, it would start to be a problem. I might get a little phase slip in here, or just the phase fluctuations would be enough to get me off by one phase. And in fact, if the thing is infinitely long, then I'll lose positional information because the whole pattern can slosh back and forth, and I won't have absolute information about position. I'll still have relative information. That is to say, I know that if I have a high concentration, then to find another guy with a high concentration, I must go one period over. But that's a different statement.
So to follow that up with another way of well-known way of getting positional information is this somatogenesis.
Yes.
So now you add time into the...
So the first observation is that this discussion is all given in the view where the signal is carried by the value at, well, by a value, which you can either think of as being the value at one moment in time or the average over some period of time, but not a trajectory. Okay? And so, yes, you can try and redo the whole thing in a picture where you have more dynamic things. The hard thing that one would like to do, that I honestly have no idea how to do, is to have a way of comparing the sort of intrinsically dynamical ways of transmitting information versus things that are quasi-static, and ask, what is the parameter underneath that tells you when you're supposed to do one rather than the other? And I don't know how to do that problem.
So thinking about drawing parallels between the two lectures, if I think about the last lecture, where you maximized entropy given some fixed constraint, say, average energy. Now, if I just consider that to be the average energy to be an input and say the distribution is a delta function on the energy, can I not just claim that I'm, in fact, maximizing the mutual information of the input distribution, which is, in this case, the delta function around the energy, and then the outputs, which is whatever you're trying to measure? So I mean, in this case, you'd just be setting P of S in your mutual information over here to a delta function.
So, so you want to argue that a maximum entropy distribution somehow provides you with the most mutual information between the thing whose expectation value you were fixing
precisely
and the microscopic variables that you can measure. I just don't think that's true. But I mean, it's an interesting line of thought, which I haven't done. But I think that particular statement isn't true. Sorry.
It's all right.
But yeah, it. So. If you want me to say what I think is the connection between what I said yesterday and what I'm saying today, I can try that.
But, since you're offering.
Yeah. Thank you for asking. So, you know, where we ended yesterday was that many of these networks appear to be near criticality. And indeed, one of the things which is maximized near criticality are various measures of mutual information. So in the simplest version of this, if you have local interactions, the diverging correlation length means that remote parts of the system are as informative about one another as they can possibly be in this family, at least in this space of models. Right? So away from criticality, you know, knowing what's happening over here doesn't really tell you anything about what's happening over here. And it's only near criticality that that happens. This network, as I mentioned, as you move in the parameters of these feedback strengths, you get that, you know, there is a transition. And I mentioned that as you approach that transition, you develop long timescales, which could, in principle, serve to suppress noise and enhance information transmission. First observation, we don't really know that the solution to the maximum optimization of information transmission places the network at criticality. We don't know that for sure. It can't place it too far away from criticality, but we don't know that it places it at criticality. Nonetheless, one of the things you could do is to ask yourself, could you see in the patterns of gene expression any signatures of criticality? So this is the thing I didn't have a chance to talk about yesterday. If you approach criticality, then the fluctuations in this four-dimensional space should be dominated by fluctuations in one mode, which is the mode that, you know, which is the order parameter of the system. And so correspondingly, you should see very strong correlations among the fluctuations in these different components. And in particular, if you look, if you look at a place like this, where there's essentially only two genes that are being expressed, and the other guys are very low, then you should see nearly perfect anti-correlation. And you do. You should also see that the statement that you get a long time scale, again, this is, you know, in this neighborhood, it's a two-dimensional system. So one of the modes is associated with a long time scale, but one of them isn't. And you see that. That is to say, if you measure gene expression levels in embryos at different times, you see that one linear combination of these two quantities is moving very fast, and one of them is moving very slowly. And the slow one is the one that has the large fluctuations, and the fast one is the one that has the small fluctuations. I could keep going. But the one that most connects to what we were saying yesterday is that if you look for the high variance combination of fluctuations that's over here, and you correlate it against the high variance fluctuations over here or over here, you find that those correlations extend essentially over the entire embryo. And that's really impressive, because in some cases, you're talking about completely different genes. Right, you know, it's gene 1 minus gene 2 at this point is the fluctuations in that are correlated with gene 4 minus gene 3 at this point. Right? How does that work? Right? This is how, you know, this is at a distance which is, you know, 2/3 the length of the embryo. So that's very surprising. It could still be an artifact. There's everything that I have told you. There's always, you know, some less interesting explanation. Maybe there's also some more interesting explanation, but I can think of less interesting ones. If I could think of a more interesting one, that's the one I'd be telling you about. But it is the case that one sees, again, these sort of long-range correlations. It suggests that the underlying network is at a very non-generic point. Okay. And again, one would like to see if that comes out of the analysis.
Can you elaborate a bit more on the on how information can be obtained from the boundaries in Turing patterns? The reason I'm asking this is because of this recent article from James Sharp on how Turing patterns and morphogen gradients can interact, and this interaction together can give precise positional information in the case of chick limb development. So do you think, like,
So the first observation is that at least in the fly, the things which one calls morphogen gradients, as opposed to Turing patterns, are things which arise because of inputs at the boundaries. So it's all about boundaries. Okay. So I said this in response to McLuhan, but let me say it again, in part because I'm not sure I've ever thought it through clearly enough. So let me use this opportunity to think out loud. if I go away from the boundaries and I think about the dynamical equations that describe not this network with these inputs fixed, but rather the local concentrations of all of the relevant proteins, that's a set of reaction diffusion equations. It happens not to be in the regime that Turing studied, we think. But it's a set of reaction diffusion equations. And the initial conditions are the concentration zero everywhere. Right? When you start, there's none of this protein either. There's certainly not any of this protein. There's none of that protein. There are messenger RNAs in various places. Some of them are uniformly distributed. That doesn't give you any positional information. And a few of them are stuck to the boundaries. And that's where everything comes from. So we should really rethink all of this and say that the proper theory of positional information, whether it's in the Turing regime or the gradient regime, is about communication from the boundaries. Okay. And you know, what's the, you know, ultimately you could think, for example, so you can do simple calculations. You can ask, so these we've done. So, you know, let's think about having a source, and we let the molecules diffuse, and there's a sink at the other end. Okay? So we just get a linear gradient. But we do this with a finite number of molecules. Okay? And then we ask, well, if we are willing to imagine that the strength of the source could range from zero to some maximal value, then given that we are only allowed to use a certain number of molecules, or given that range, that dynamic range, if you measure it in molecules per second, right, then given that dynamic range, the diffusion constant and the size of the system, there is a maximum amount of information that you can transmit from the strength of the source to the concentration at any point. And you can show that bounds the amount of information that the concentration can provide about the position. Okay. But that's a case in which you didn't need to do the calculation, right? Because you can see what's you can see what's happening. The question is, can we say something like that covers all of these cases? The intuition is that, let's say we have 100 rows of cells, and at the end, everybody can do something different. I believe that somewhere I need to get log of 100 bits. Okay. And I think it's the case that I should be able to draw a box and say that, you know, there have to be arrows that go into the box that carry that information. And what that means is, so to get into more biological terms, if I told you that every cell knows what it's doing, then there's log 100 bits that it has access to. And there must therefore be some combination of regulatory arrows that carry that much information. And since the information capacity of regulatory arrows is something that we can study separately from the developmental context, right, then this connects these two things to each other. And in particular, right, to loop back to where we started, if you look at all the measurements that are available on noise levels and transcriptional regulation and so on, it is very hard to find a regulatory arrow that carries more than 2 bits. And if you're planning on you know, patterning 100 rows, right, you can start counting how many of these things you need, and you know, There aren't that many arrows, right? So this is the argument that we're down here, not up here. But we should have a better version of this notion of information propagating from the boundaries.
Thank you for the talk. We did see many themes of how biological systems operate very efficiently near the possible optimal level they can reach. But the question of what cost they have to pay did come up a bit in the first lecture.
Yes.
So I wanted to ask a bit about how do we estimate the cost that an organism has to pay to reach the optimal level it can reach. In particular, how can we include that in the formalism that you discussed today?
So, So the very short answer is, I don't know. The slightly longer answer is that I think that in this context, we're as close to that as we are anywhere. So if I ask you, what's the cost of implementing this adaptation process? I have no idea how to calculate that, right? I don't even know where to start. But here, I might worry that putting an arrow here costs something, but I'm not sure that it does. The real cost here is making all the molecules. And what's interesting is that this theoretical formulation really takes you from the number of molecules to a prediction about what you ought to be doing. And so in a very real sense, although it's optimization, but you know, as Vijay was emphasizing earlier today, you know, optimization only makes sense in a constrained setting. The question is, are the constraints something magical that, you know, if you're not careful, right, all of the power is in the constraints and not in the thing you're optimizing. If I, you know, if I tell you, build me the best X, but by the way, also be sure to do A, B, C, D, E, and F, hold all of those fixed, right? Then the prediction that you make really comes more from A through F than it does from the fact that you're optimizing X. So what's interesting about this calculation, I think, is that it comes, you know, very close to saying, you tell me how many molecules you're willing to use, and I'll tell you how to use them. If you tell me you're willing to use a different number of molecules, you're supposed to do something different. Slightly more subtle. Do these molecules come at the same price as those molecules? When you do this trick of, which really shouldn't be living out there like that. Let's try. Okay. When you do this trick of constitutively expressing the messenger RNA, so in fact, we should really have a little box. This really goes to a box, right, that has the messenger RNA in it. You know, is how do I compare the cost? So this allows me, by having these messenger RNAs here, it allows me to make use of lower concentrations of this molecule. How do I compare the cost of making proteins versus making messenger RNAs? Right? So in this problem, I think we can get closer to exploring those questions very concretely. As I move over to that side of the board, I can say the word. I don't know how to write down anything that is compelling. I mean, I can make stuff up, right? You know, people have discussed, for example, the notion of metabolically efficient neural codes, which actually is a good idea because it's plausible that the costs are roughly proportional to the number of action potentials you generate and so on. But beyond that, it's very hard. Whereas here, I think we have a shot at it. I don't think we know the answer, but I think we have a shot at it.
Right. So basically, the constraints are very specific to the system being considered. And as you said, we can use metabolic efficiency as a constraint for neural codes. So if we were to know what the constraints are, say in this simple model here of the bacteria in the environment, how would we try to determine what would be the level at which?
So look, in this simple model, right, the costs. Well, there's a cost which is already in here, which is that when I write this function, I presumably have in it the cost of making the E molecules. What I haven't done is to say, well, in order to get this much information, I need to have a sensing and control mechanism that connects the sugar concentration to the enzyme concentration. That presumably comes at a cost. And that's not here. On the other hand, that is a problem that starts to look like the problem over there. So maybe this is another argument that don't worry about this side of the board. look at that side of the board. But you're right in the sense that the examples that I've given you are ones in which, let's say, non-fundamental costs don't appear to play a role. So for example, I don't have to tell you, oh, yes, you would like your synapse to implement this nonlinearity, because that's the optimal thing to do. But you know, in order to do that, it would take instead of 1,200 things at the synapse, it would take 1,400, and that costs too much, so you could only build these nonlinearities. We didn't do anything like that. I think, actually, that precisely because of things like what OP was talking about, that even the components in the nervous system are themselves enormously complicated at the molecular level. The notion that there's something you're not going to do because, you know, you can't make it out of the parts that are available to you, I think has become vastly less plausible over the last 30 years. So 30 years ago, people would say, well, you know, the whole idea of neural networks is that neurons are simple and brain function is complicated, so it all should be in the network. I still think it's true that most of what happens is in the network, but the initial statement that neurons are simple is just false, right? So, as you look down, you see more and more richness that you could rearrange in different ways, right?
Okay, I think we'll stop with that. So let's thank Bill for a wonderful set of lectures.
Thank you.